investigating money laundering, money leaving Angola to acquire a Swiss company owned by Mr. Alvaro Sobrinho?
Madam Speaker, if the Honourable Member has got this information, I will try to pass on this information to the FSC. Madam Speaker, I am informed by the Financial Services Commission that four applications for an investment banking license under Section 79A of the Financial Services Act have been received as at date. Out of the four applicants, two have already received their licenses. They are namely Alvaro Sobrinho Africa Limited on 25th November 2016 and Devere Investment Advisory Mauritius Limited on 30th. Alvaro Sobrinho Africa Limited on 25th November 2016.
I'm working this side of the street.
Who is Alvaro Sobrinho? Well, an enigmatic personage that is making the headlines of all newspapers in Mauritius for what is now known as the Alvaro saga, involving allegations of corruption at the highest state level. But one thing is certain. The Alvaro saga is making the ruling elite in Mauritius nervous. Really nervous.
Et les investisseurs vont lire cette presse et vont se dire, mon Dieu, je vais aller mettre de l'argent dans ce pays où il y a une presse qui peut me descendre alors que je n'ai rien fait.
Vous faire un appel à la presse et à votre parti politique pour être prudent et responsable dans votre commentaire.
Madame Fakim, tu as une relation avec M. Alvaro?
Vous caméramen, tout est fait.
Qui représentation?
De Alvaro Sobrinho, 2015, hosted by Osubada.
I got an invitation. I wasn't there. And you have no right to mention my name in the papers. I got an invitation. Understood?
Thank you very much,
everyone. You just said you want us to give the truth. How to give the truth if you don't answer questions?
Thank you very much for coming.
We have all the personal questions for you.
Thank you very much. But
unfortunately, you have not answered our questions on the statement.
So we can deal with the questions in turn.
Just a minute, chubby.
To understand more about the Alvaro saga, we will need to start with this man, Manuel Vicente. Vicente was charged by the state of Portugal of money laundering in 2011, just 1 year before he became vice president of Angola. At the time of the charges, Vicente was the CEO of Sonangol, the National Fuel Society of Angola, which is the exclusive licensee for exploration of oil and gas in the basement and on the continental shelf of Angola. The investigation by Portugal at that time unveiled a massive corruption network. The money laundering allegation was linked to the acquisition of property in Lisbon, Portugal, by Vicente. According to Maca Angola, an initiative dedicated to the struggle against corruption and defense of democracy in Angola, the money used by Vicente came from toxic loans. These loans, amounting to some $6.8 billion, benefited Angolan elites, among which Manuel Vicente. Who provided these loans? a bank in Angola named Banco Espírito Santo Angola, commonly known as BESA, which is a subsidiary of the Banco Espírito Santo of Portugal, which has been at the center of huge controversy. 19% of BESA is owned by the actual president's daughter, Isabel dos Santos, and 24% of BESA belongs to Portmill, a company partly owned by Manuel Vicente himself. And this is where our protagonist Alvaro Sobrinho comes in. As the CEO of the Banco Espírito Santo Angola, from 2002 to 2012, he was the one who approved those toxic loans. According to Switzerland media, Alvaro Sobrinho is also the beneficiary of one of these loans amounting to some 500 million of US dollars. Alvaro Sobrinho has been facing justice in Portugal and Switzerland for money laundering. In Switzerland, an amount of some 160 million US dollars of Alvaro Sobrinho has been frozen in relation to the Banco Espírito Santo affair. In Portugal, Sobrinho has had better luck so far. Orlando Figueira, the Portuguese public prosecutor who investigated the money laundering affair that incriminated Manuel Vicente and Alvaro Sobrinho, filed the case with no charge for both of them. But meanwhile, Orlando Figueira is being charged in Portugal for corruption. He has to answer for a bribe of 760,000 euros to shelve an investigation into Vicente's dealing in Portugal before he became vice president. In the meantime, in July 2015, the newly appointed president of the Republic of Mauritius, Amina Garib Fakim, was designated as vice chairperson and trustee of Planet Earth Institute, whose founding chairman is Alvaro Sobrinho. Strangely though, Planet Earth Institute, which presents itself as an NGO, is in fact a registered company in the UK. But in any case, it did not take long for business to follow philanthropy. In August 2015, Alvaro Sobrinho made three applications for Category 1 Global Business, known as GBC1, to the Finance Services Commission of Mauritius. He made a further demand in September 2016 for an investment banking license. During his venue to Mauritius, no other than the secretary to the president of the Republic of Mauritius, Deodas Apadu, deployed the red carpet for Alvaro Sobrinho. His zeal has even been subject to parliamentary question.
Amen. Madam Speaker, in regard to part E of the question, Mr. Sobrinho was granted access to the arrival and departure VIP lounges at Sesiusaga Rambulam International Airport following requests made by the Secretary to the President on 31 occasions during the period 1st of October 2015 to 21st February 2017. Mr. Sobrinho was accompanied by his family members or close collaborators on 21 occasions.
According to Mauritian newspaper L'Express, Mr. Apadu even appealed to the Finance Services Commission on 8 occasions to support the request for licenses for Sobrinho. The same Apadu, unsurprisingly, requested 1 year leave without pay from his post as Secretary to the President in February of 2017 to work for Vango Property Limited, a real estate company incorporated in Mauritius in June 2016 and owned by Alvaro Sobrinho. The interest of Sobrinho for property investment, just as it has been the case in Switzerland and Portugal, has also been pointed out during one of the parliamentary sessions in Mauritius. On the 4th April 2017, one question was about the acquisition of some 131 villas and apartments in a real estate investment project in the northern part of Mauritius, known as Royal Park.
I tell you what I do.
We could have said that coincidence has put Mauritius on the way of Sobrinho. But no. Incorporation of offshore companies by embezzlers or other crooks to siphon money out of Angola is absolutely no coincidence. The Panama Papers revealed how Angola's sovereign wealth fund, a vehicle of development and prosperity for Angola, is being plundered by a complex mechanism. This mechanism implies the son of the president of Angola, Dos Santos, Zanu, who heads the Fondo Soberano de Angola, FSDEA, which is the name of the sovereign wealth fund. Zanu has at some point partly owned Banco Kwanza and another company that we will name X for legal reasons. Those entities are now headed by his friend Mr. Know How to Steal. And both Banco Kwanza and Company X have FSDEA as a client for mainly investment purposes. Mr. Know How to Steal, who is a close friend to Zeno dos Santos, was another member of Banco Kwanza and Company X, been convicted in Switzerland for repeated qualified criminal mismanagement. Well, guess what? Company X set up a collective investment scheme management company in Mauritius in May 2016. What makes Mauritius such an interesting place for money laundering?
You would say that the fact that, as all offshore centres, there's a lot of secrecy involved, and the fact that there's such a great deal of secrecy makes it very attractive, obviously, for people who've got things to hide to actually open what we call post box companies here in Mauritius. And obviously, when you're competing with other countries across the globe for a place in the sun in terms of offshore companies and offshore sector in itself, you tend to be a bit flexible on your rules and regulations, and also on the what you would term as KYC, know your clients procedures. Because even us in Mauritius, we've had problems with offshore, with companies registered in offshore jurisdictions. For example, a few years back, we had a company which wanted to construct a coal-powered station in Mauritius, and it was very difficult for us Mauritians who were against that project to actually get to know who was behind that project, because that said company was registered in Malaysia, in a district where they had secrecy rules, as in all the best offshore centers across the world. A lot of people are using the offshore facilities of Mauritius not for the right reasons, but for the tax evasion reasons or for the money laundering reasons. And obviously, you're in touch with people who work in the sector as well, and they give you a very interesting insight of what the industry is about. So we were critical of the offshore industry, especially that part where we thought the authorities were not doing enough to have full compliance with what international laws said, or full compliance with respect to national legislation as well. We had a regulatory body for financial investments the Financial Services Commission, also known as the FSC. Currently, half of the board of the FSC has resigned, and it is widely known across Mauritius that there's been huge political interference in the enforcement of regulatory laws in Mauritius. A lot of what people or the authorities or the politicians have told us over the years is that we always need to welcome foreign direct investment, irrespective of who is investing and why these people are investing. And a lot of people in Mauritius think that that's the case. So that then, like, it's no more a case of it. We can't have a debate about it anymore. No, you just need to stay quiet because that's the way it is. We need foreign direct investment. So I think for Mauritius, developing the offshore sector was one way in which our political elite or our political former political regimes, that's one way they thought about like addressing the need for foreign currency. As an economy, you want to be able to produce things that add value. And when you're just taking, when you're kind of creating a sector which is just taking tax revenue from other countries where economic activity happens and you're just stealing that from them, my party and I as well, as an economist, we do not see it as a sustainable solution. Well, cost of living is becoming really expensive in Mauritius, and we got a very regressive fiscal system, which when you aggregate everything together, if you're someone who's got who's not a rich millionaire, if you're not someone if you don't belong to the 10% of the richest Mauritians, you probably have a very difficult life here. With offshore, unfortunately, you don't add any value. You're just a very cheap competitor, and it's a bit immoral as well. Like, just imagine your economy yourself, where all your people and all the resources of the economy would be directed towards some economic activity, and at the end of the day, when it's a time for the government to tax the profits of that economic activity to get back some money and to address things like inequality of income and everything like that, provision of basic services, education, health and stuff like that. But just imagine if that company, just because another jurisdiction was offering lower taxes, routed all the money back to the other jurisdiction and didn't pay any taxes to your economy. How would you feel? So if you're living in a global village, you should be fair one upon each other. And we shouldn't steal the hard-earned tax money of other countries. But actually, we're not stealing it. We're just like we're just allowing those companies not to pay that to society. And that is wrong.
All this being said, what we really need to know is who wins and loses.
Ladies and gentlemen,
this is an actual robbery. Who wins? It's clear that it is the ruling elite. But who really loses is the people and democracy of respective countries involved in this massive money laundering plot. And through its offshore system that is exonerating illicit money, Mauritius as a state is being accomplice of plunder, ultimately bearing the responsibility of failing basic human rights services that are not being provided in countries like Angola. Mauritian laws are constantly being changed to accommodate the booty of all sorts of crooks that are plundering other countries, and at the same time to acquire property of locals who find it more and more difficult to buy land and houses due to constant increase in the price of property. The price paid for Angolan people is terrible. The health system in Angola is among the worst in the world. Though health is supposedly a free public service, infant mortality rate there is, according to the World Health Organization, among the highest in the world. Angola has only 3,700 doctors for a population of some 24 million.
I couldn't imagine suffering worse than what I'd seen in the hospitals. Then I met Delfina Fernandez.
The hardest thing for any parent is to lose a child, and you've lost 10 children. Whose fault is that?
Não estava lá médico. Enfermeiro não estava. Tem que tirar o medicamento desse de raiz. Não aguenta.
Delfina is blind in one eye and suffers from rotting teeth that cause agonizing pain every waking moment. She doesn't even know that Angola is rich. The only petroleum in her world is the gasoline that she uses to rinse her mouth to numb her toothache. Do you know whether Angola has a lot of oil and gas?
Aquele só tem que comprar para meter aqui dentro, para matar só aquele bicho que está lá. Meter na lockdown, para meter só aqui.
Petróleo?
É.
No more lies. No more lies. No more lies. We gotta take the power back.
Check. We're gonna have to break it down.